Hello everyone. Welcome to the Future City Waste Not Want Not theme webinar. My name is Maggie Dressel and I'm the program manager for the Future City competition. I'm so glad you all could join us this afternoon for the webinar. You're going to hear a lot of great information from our pretty fantastic subject experts that are here with us today. We hope that it'll help you start brainstorming for what your team's futuristic waste management system might look like. Before we jump into the webinar itself, I wanted to share some information that might be especially helpful for the teachers and the audience today. Future City is one of many programs organized by Discover E, which is a nonprofit organization dedicated to helping people discover and the many opportunities that go along with it. I highly suggest that you visit discovere.org. And there's a huge number of free resources for you to download that you can use in your classroom even after Future City is over. I also wanted to give you a heads up about two other exciting Discover E programs that you might be hearing more about in the coming weeks and months. The first is Girl Day 2016, a program dedicated to engaging girls in engineering. We're asking people to sign up to be role models. So if you're interested, you can sign up at discovere.org/girlday, and then you'll start receiving emails with resources, advice, and ideas on how to engage girls in engineering. The other program is brand new and called Global Day of the Engineer. It's happening on February 24th, 2016, and we're asking people to take a pledge to either celebrate engineering, engage students, or share a local engineering project via social media. You can visit discovere.org/globalday to make your pledge and join the excitement to show that engineers make a difference. Now, let's get back to Future City and our Waste Not Want Not webinar. This webinar is using voice over internet, so if the sound quality is not good, we also have a teleconference. You might on the phone number that you see on your screen right now, along with the code. The audio pin will be shown on your computer after you join the webinar. This webinar and the slides will be posted on Future City's website, which is futurecity.org, in the resources section, hopefully tomorrow, but definitely by the end of this week. And we have a short question survey for you that we would love for you to complete at the end of this webinar. We are always looking for ways to improve the Future City program, and your feedback will help us create future webinars and other quality resources to use. I bet you'll have lots of questions to ask throughout the webinar. I ask that you type those questions in the question space that you should see on the right-hand side of the screen on your control panel. We have all of your microphones so we can hear the panelists today. At the end of the presentation, we will have 15-20 minutes for the panelists themselves to answer your questions. So definitely be thinking about what you'd like to ask them. So let's begin our webinar. I am happy to introduce our Martin Flans from Bentley Systems, Dr. Brian Staley from the Environmental Research and Education Foundation from the Oak Ridge National Laboratory. I'm going to start off with Martin, who is our host and master of ceremonies today. He is a professional and has been with Bentley for 9 years. During those 9 years, he's worn a lot of different hats at Bentley. He's been a trainer for hydraulics and hydrology, a consultant, an application manager, a manager, and a product marketing manager. Lots of different skills there, Martin. Today, he leads a team focused on the research and design of the use surrounding Bentley Software's products. Prior to joining Bentley, Martin actually worked as an environmental engineer and designed the construction and managed the design and construction of a wide variety of water-related projects. Basically, anything having to do with what you drink or you flush, both very important. Martin is also a long-time supporter of Future City. He has been a team mentor and has served as a judge on both the regional and national levels. So thank you so much for joining us today, Martin.
Thank you, Mackie. Just want to make sure my audio is working.
Yep, we can.
All right, great. If you can, please thank you for the introduction.
Yep, there we go.
Okay, everybody. Today you have two great speakers that will be coming up, Dr. Stolle and Dr. Webb. And before we get to those speakers, I wanted to ask you to just sit there and think just for a moment. The city that you are building in SimCity, the city that you're building in the model, how is it going to become its future? But someday, what if it became real? So I just want to ask you to think, just for a brief moment, how, if you design this city, will it actually real people's lives for the water they need, the power consumption or the power demands for that city, how to handle the waste, and you're going to hear more about that today, transportation, communications, food, and all of these things that are going on in the city, how is it going to go from virtual to real world? And that's something that actually personally really excites me. Next slide, please. So engineers today, if actually designing something, they would design it in the virtual world, just like you're doing. But somehow they have to get to real world. The good news is your program handbook has the actual process that engineers would follow, and it's called the engineering process. So let's say it's for a something that we may hear about later from either Dr. Stolle or Dr. Webb. They would define the scope. How big does the waste system need to be? How much capacity does it need to have? You would identify the requirements. How often would it have to be operating? And come up with an try this initial design, say, Thanksgiving, the day after Thanksgiving or the day after Christmas. Can the system handle that much waste or that much material? And then through that testing, redesign the system. And then once you redesign it and you're satisfied with it, build the real thing, and then show others how to use it. So that same process that engineers would follow, you yourselves are probably already following with your virtual city or with your model of the city. Next slide, please. So that therein lies the real excitement that I have with this future city competition itself and the career that I have, where it really excites me to be able to virtually model an entire water network for a city. Municipality, to play around with it on the computer, try the worst case scenarios, use the engineering process that you have on page 12 in your handbook again, design and come up with the best system, and then watch it be built by contractors, and then watch it be put into place. So again, that's something that really excites me, and I just wanted you to take a moment to think about this virtual, how it could become real, and the steps that you need to go through to do that. So with that said, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the first speaker, Maggie, next slide. The first speaker, Dr. Brian Stolle. Dr. Brian Stolle is a licensed professional engineer and the president and chief executive officer at the Environmental Research and Education Foundation in Raleigh, North Carolina. He's been heavily involved in research related to the decomposition of waste sources and the real ecology. He has a PhD in civil engineering with a minor in biotechnology. Some impressive things there. He's going to be treating us to an introduction to waste management itself and highlighting some current issues we face in dealing with solid waste today. Over to you, Brian.
Great. Thank you very much, Martin. And that was a great introduction. So welcome, everybody. Thank you for having me today. Maggie and the rest of the Future City folks. And what I'd like to do today is just to give you an introduction to a day in the life of your garbage. So we'll be talking trash and about a lot of things. Next slide, please. So for today, think about these. These are today's trashy questions. And basically, if you go through these, what we're going to highlight really, and Martin kind of emphasized well, interconnected processes and how that becomes a core infrastructure for a particular city. And that's what I do today, is really to connect the dots between how does garbage come into being? How do we make garbage? How does it get managed? Where does it go? And then when it goes to where it its endpoint, how is it managed at that endpoint? So these particular questions really get to the core of that, and I'll pick out a couple. I won't read them all. I figure you all can scan through that. But what are the sources of municipal solid waste? How is the waste collected? Where does it go? And then once it gets to its endpoint, what happens there? And we'll talk about how the waste that we generate is segmented and goes into different endpoints as we go through the presentation here. And I'll try to pull out some issues and some facts that hopefully will help you as you consider the competition, as you consider systems. So next slide. So first thing, let's define a couple of quick terms. What is solid waste? Solid waste is a broader term that basically describes, or basically is any solid or semi-solid material that is no longer wanted by its owner and is discarded or abandoned. So that would include everything from the household garbage that we generate to junk cars to industrial waste and everything else. That's a pretty broad scope. So we're going to talk about a smaller slice of that pie, so to speak. Municipal solid waste, or MSW, and I'll use the term MSW throughout my presentation, but that's solid waste that's discarded by the public. That's you and me. It has many aliases: garbage, trash, rubbish, discards, and litter. Next slide. So let me just make this statement, and I think most of you are probably familiar with this, but managing solid waste is a core infrastructure need for society. Next slide. And that you might ask the question, like, what are you talking about here? Because many times when we think about core infrastructure, as Martin mentioned, we're talking about water. We're talking about wastewater. Next slide. But when you think about core infrastructure needs for a particular city, take a look at this picture and take a look at the top infrastructure needs. You've got power, and you can just keep hitting the button till we have all the red circles here. You've got power, transportation, clean water, wastewater treatment, information technology, which really wasn't a core infrastructure need 50 years ago, and then lastly, waste management. Many people don't think of waste management as a core infrastructure need because many times if you think about water, power, things like that, you have a meter on that. At your home, you have a power meter. At your home, you have a water meter, and you know exactly how much water is coming into your house, exactly how much power is coming into your house. You don't really have that with solid waste, and so in many ways, it's an often overlooked infrastructure need, but it is a true infrastructure need. Next slide, please. So let's talk about that. Why do we really care about waste? Although we talked about it being a core infrastructure need, what happens if we don't manage the waste that we generate? Next slide. It can infect our environment. This is a picture showing that what happens if we don't put waste where it's supposed to be. It ends up in places like a beach, and I don't know anybody who would really want to go play on this beach. Would not be a fun beach to go visit. Next slide. Another thing that Martin also touched on was the ability to get clean drinking water. Much of that drinking water comes from our streams, our rivers, our lakes. Imagine pumping water out of this particular stream and trying to treat that and drink from it. Most people would not want to do that. So there are some significant health issues if we don't properly manage our waste. And then from a socioeconomic standpoint, next slide. Again, thinking of it as a core infrastructure need, if we don't properly manage our waste, especially in large urban cities, something like this could happen where if it's not collected, literally garbage can clog the streets to where cars can't pass, you can't walk. It can be a huge problem. That has actually happened on a few occasions in New York City where workers have gone on strike and you end up with a situation like this. So most of the time we don't think about waste because it's efficiently managed and pulled away from where we generate it. But when that system stops working, or stops working well, we become very aware of how important properly managing waste is. Next slide. Okay, so where does waste come from? Next slide. Well, the short answer, it comes from you, me, our society as a whole. But we as engineers, many times, to be able to manage things and design processes, we tend to think of things in categories. And one way we can categorize waste, next slide, is based on where it comes from. One of the first sources that would be kind of obvious would be residential sources. Another category of where waste might come from is probably where many of you are at now, either at your work or at an institutional location such as a school, whether that's a university or an elementary school or so on. Those would all be institutional sources. Next slide. And then there are commercial sources. So commercial sources, that is a broad category. That could include an office building, for example. Next slide. It could include where you go to buy food or eat food. A grocery store is a prime example. It could be a restaurant as well. And next slide. And it could also be a place where you shop. And so you, as you go through your day, think about that. You start at your home, you go to work or school, you may go shopping afterwards or out to eat. You generate garbage every single place you go to in some form or fashion. And so many times when we're managing waste, we're thinking about where is it coming from, because where it comes from really defines how it's going to be managed along the way. Next slide. So let's think about that. How much garbage is there out there? We Americans generate around 382.5 million tons of garbage, or 765 billion pounds of MSW in a single year. Next slide. That's about 7 pounds of trash per person each day, or 2,600 pounds in a year. That's a lot of garbage. So to put that in perspective, next slide, think about that. Over the course of a year, you as a person generate a cube of trash 8 foot high by 8 foot wide by 8 foot deep. That's your trash footprint. So every year you've got one of these cubes of garbage that you're generating. So put that in perspective, that's going to be just below the net of a typical 10 foot high basketball goal. That's a lot of garbage. Next slide. So the other thought that you might, that might come to you is, well, what's in this cube of garbage? So this is some data from the US EPA that basically defines kind of what typical types of waste are in our garbage. And again, think about this from a process standpoint, from an engineering standpoint. What's in the garbage is extremely important, because the processes that are designed to manage the waste are highly dependent on what's actually in the garbage. So think about that. I've called this the top stash in the trash. So the top four key items that are in garbage consist of paper, about 27%, food waste, yard trimmings. Even though you may not mow the grass, or you may not even live in a place that has a large yard, a lot of times your daily life intersects in places where there are landscaped areas and things where some of these yard trimmings are generated. And so that gets disposed of. And then plastic would be the fourth item. So if you just take those four items alone, and if you look at the pie chart, you'll see, yes, there are other items there, glass, metals, wood, and so on. But just those four items alone make up about two-thirds of everything we throw away. Next slide. Okay, so I mentioned that it's important in terms of what's in the garbage. So let's think about that. So once we generate the garbage, it's got to go somewhere. Well, the first place it goes, it begins with the bin. It's going to go in a bin somewhere in the vast majority of the locations in the developed world. So a typical place for your house or for a public venue such as a park or a convenience store or so on, it's going to go into some kind of trash receptacle. That's going to be your receptacles on the left. Okay, and then on the right, if you're at a shopping center, if you're at an office, yes, you may throw away something inside in a trash can, but that's quickly going to get deposited into something like a dumpster like you see here. So think about that. One, you're putting this material in a bin. Then it's got to go to where it's going to be managed. Next slide. And that is done via garbage trucks or waste refuse vehicles, if you want to call it that. But this is the key point here. Note that depending on what kind of bin you have, that really dictates what kind of truck will collect that waste. So for a residential or public venue, the typical truck you might see out on the street is called a side load truck. It's kind of obvious why we call it that, because it loads the garbage can from the side of the truck with a mechanical arm, automatically lifts it up and puts it in the garbage truck. Yet, when you're at a commercial or an institutional location and you have these dumpsters, you can't use that kind of truck. What you use is called a front load truck that literally lifts the dumpster up over and dumps that material in the back of the truck. Next slide. There is a third kind of truck that we see. This kind of truck has actually been declining in recent years because side load and front load trucks tend to be the ones most commonly used. But in densely urban areas or in other areas where there are space constraints, you see a rear load truck, which, as the name implies, you load the trash in from the back. This works well where you've got heavy traffic situations or narrow alleyways or things like that. So all three types of trucks are basically used to collect the garbage into a location where then that material can be transported. Next slide. Okay, so a word from Captain Not So Obvious. Did you know that roughly half of the solid waste workers are garbage truck drivers? Next slide. What that means really is that waste management as a core infrastructure is a transport industry. Most of us don't think about that, but the vast majority of the employees in the solid waste industry are driving garbage trucks. The other factor is that it's an extremely dangerous industry. Transporting waste is the fifth most dangerous occupation in America. There are dozens of fatalities each year associated with garbage collection. So that is a big issue. Next slide. Okay, so now that we've figured out, you know, how we generate the waste and how we collect it, the next question is, where does the garbage go? So right now in the U.S., about two-thirds of MSW goes to a landfill. That's about 66%. So a lot of our waste still goes to a landfill, even though we receive a lot of information about recycling, and there's a lot of information out there to make sure that we recycle as much as we can. But still, a good chunk of the waste goes to a landfill. About one quarter of the waste is recycled, and then the rest either is composted or is burned to create energy. And we'll go over each one of these endpoints right now. But one quick word about this, though, is that think about, again, what is in the waste. And what is in the waste really dictates how we can manage it in some form or fashion. As I mentioned, you know, we're transporting a lot of this waste with trucks. If you wanted to blow the waste, such as Walt Disney World does, if you'll note, Walt Disney World can only blow the waste that's light enough to blow. So they don't blow all the waste in the tunnels underneath the Walt Disney World. You hear a lot about waste being blown in these tunnels, but really it's the light waste like paper products and plastic film and things like that that are being blown around. You really can't blow food waste around. It's too heavy, it's too wet. So that's an example of how different kinds of waste materials require different kinds of management or processes in that particular scenario. So think about that as you're thinking about how to manage garbage. Really, it's about what's in the garbage that can be really important if you're designing a particular process. So let's take a look at the processes in terms of how waste is currently managed. Next slide. So this is a schematic of a modern landfill. So I want to differentiate that because today's landfills are highly engineered systems. There are many engineers that work to create a landfill and to design a landfill. So they're sometimes you hear the word dump. Dump was what these things used to be called back in the 1960s and 70s when they were not an engineered system. They literally were basically holes in the ground. And a lot of the issues that you see with water contamination, groundwater contamination, and so on, have to do with those old archaic type of situations, the dumps that really aren't engineered. So I'll highlight a couple of things about this picture. First off, look around on the red-orange section. That constitutes the liner system for a landfill. It's first you have clay, then on top of that you have plastic liners, and then if you know, kind of working from the bottom of the picture up, you've got a piping system. That's to collect the wastewater that comes from the garbage as it's placed, or from rainwater that touches that garbage and then seeps down. That's called leachate. That is pumped out, that is treated at wastewater treatment systems typically, and so that's managed. Then if you go up, there's another set of pipes that collect landfill gas. I'll touch on that in a minute. But then if you go on up further, you'll see that the garbage is placed in these areas that kind of look like almost like skin cells. And that's really what it ends up being, is you create a pocket, or you place waste in kind of a pocket, and then you encapsulate that waste with soil or other material. Now, where they're placing the waste on this landfill is called the working face. But the job of the bulldozer drivers, you see the yellow pieces of equipment in this picture, their job is to make sure the waste is compacted as tightly as possible, and then that material is covered with soil or other kind of material to keep the waste odors and birds and other things, other animals and so on from digging around in that waste, to just keep everything as clean as possible. And so that's something that it's obvious, is that this is really a highly orchestrated, complex management operation here. You have someone out on this working face that's like a traffic controller who's managing traffic and telling people where to go at any given time. The other thing to note from this, if you look on the right side of the picture, you'll see some buildings depicted that say methane facility, and then you'll see some power lines that say electricity generated at methane facility. So that means, next slide, that means that landfills have gas. So let me talk about landfill gas for a minute. It's kind of a double-edged sword. Landfills make gas that consists primarily of methane and carbon dioxide, about half and half ratio. Methane is used in turbines to create electricity or heat. That's a good thing. But methane is also a powerful greenhouse gas that must be controlled. So if you have landfills not properly controlling their gas emissions, that's a huge contributor to greenhouse gas emissions. So that's one of the main limitations of landfills, is that The perspective is, one, they're making greenhouse gases if the gas isn't being properly controlled, and then also, over a long period of time, there certainly is the potential, if the landfills still are not actively managed, then you do have the potential for there being pollution issues there. So those are the two big limitations with landfills. But let's talk about the gas a little bit more. So the gas is made by microbes called methanogens. This is pretty common amongst engineered systems. In fact, you see this at wastewater treatment plants a lot, where these methanogens are used to biodegrade materials. Next slide. Biodegradable materials, as you might suspect, things like food, paper, cardboard, sludge. Non-biodegradables would be plastic, glass, soil, and so on. Next slide. I just threw in a picture of a methanogen. They're kind of cool looking. I did my research on this, so I kind of like it. I think this is a methanogen selfie. Next slide. Okay, and there's some real pictures of landfills. I won't go through all of these, but basically so you can get a sense for what happens. I mean, if you go from left to right, you'll see the liner installation, placing the liner, the design of that, you end up with a finished lined landfill area. And then once it's in operation, you can see a picture of the working face with the equipment, as I noted. And then the gas well, as noted here, just exemplifies that this is an actively managed type of technology. Next slide. So let's move on to the next management method. And as I mentioned, 23% of the waste that we generate is recycled by facilities called MRFs, or material recovery facilities. You could call it a recycling facility. The typical, industry term for this is a MRF. And its primary purpose is to separate materials into usable materials that can be sold for repurposing. Main categories include paper, metal, plastic, and glass. Next slide. Okay, so this is just shows the anatomy of a MRF, and I have some pictures. I'll go through this in more detail. But in essence, the general steps when you bring waste into a MRF is that there is some pre-sorting involved. That's typically done by people, not machines. They pre-sort material. Paper is then pulled out of that line. And so imagine a conveyor belt with all of this mixed recyclable material. It goes by people. They take out stuff that isn't supposed to be recycled in the first place. Then machines pull out paper, then machines remove some of the glass and fines. Glass is typically crushed up. Then you pull out the ferrous metals, so anything that a magnet will attract, you will pull out at this step. Then you pull out aluminum with a cool little device called an eddy current separator. It flips the aluminum materials right off the belt into a container, and then you separate the remaining plastics in its different categories. Next slide. So let's do a quick picture tour of a MRF. So, the top picture here shows what's called the tipping floor. It's called a tipping floor because you literally tip the truck, the waste that's in the truck, onto the floor, and then the little front-end loaders then scoop the material and put it right on a conveyor belt where it goes right up into the picking line. But I want to note one thing. Next slide. That if you look at that pile of recyclable materials there, about 10 to 40% of that material is really not supposed to be there. What that means is that people have put things in recycling bins that really aren't recyclable. That's a bad thing because that basically increases the work. It's not as sustainable because you're adding more energy to deal with the waste when in fact it's not recyclable in the first place. So, and we call that a contamination rate at a MRF. It means that 10 to 40% of the material that's on that floor will end up going to likely a landfill anyway because it wasn't recyclable in the first place. Then the second slide below this, I want to point out these are the workers that are picking out materials, but look at the tubes that fall from the ceiling. Next slide. Those materials are gigantic suction tubes that take care of MRF enemy number one. Slide, please. MRF enemy number one is the plastic film bag, plastic bags, and so on. Those will clog up equipment and are the main source of equipment failures at MRFs, and that's why many times you'll find that these kind of materials are not accepted as recyclable materials. So that's a key thing to note. It's a big process limitation. Then materials go through these cardboard screens where the screens literally pull big cardboard up out of the screen. Everything else falls through. As I mentioned, the magnet is literally a gigantic magnet that pulls the ferrous materials out. Next slide. And then you'll see so optical sorting is generally done. These optical sorters are pretty cool. They basically shine lights on the belt, and for different kinds of plastic, that activates a certain piece of equipment that literally blows a puff of air on the conveyor belt that'll blow particular types of plastics off the belt into specific kinds of containers. So it's pretty neat to watch. You just see, all you hear are puffs of air going, and you see plastic flipped off into different containers. That's pretty neat. You have the eddy current separator, as I mentioned, to separate aluminum down at the bottom. And then last but not least, what ends up happening once all the materials are separated is it goes to a baler, and except for the glass. Next slide, please. The glass goes into a bunker, but here's an example of some of the finished products. You see baled plastic in different colors, baled paper, metals, and so on, and those then are sold to companies who then remake plastic bottles, make new paper materials, metals, and so on. Next slide. Okay, so let's just talk real quickly. What can be recycled? This is just a picture from a typical school in California, and you'll note that you can recycle some items and some items you can't, although you'll note that some of these items are things I've noted that could be recyclable, like plastic wrap, like food, juice boxes, and so on, and those are supposed to go in the trash. So next slide. You may ask the question, next slide, wait a minute, why can't everything be recycled? So the deal is that non-recyclable items placed in recycle bins can cause more harm than good if placed in the trash bin. And I noted that about plastic bags. But in many cases, what happens is that this is a situation where manufacturers make things that really aren't recyclable. And so we have a challenge when we're trying to manage waste in actually recycling that material. A juice box is a perfect example where it consists of a cardboard layer, but then fused onto that is a plastic layer to keep the juice fresh. But now you have a plastic layer glued to a cardboard layer. You cannot separate those out easily, and so therefore it is very challenging to recycle that. So this points to an issue that when you talk about waste management, it's not just a waste problem. It is a problem on what are we buying and how are things being manufactured far upstream. Think of a manufacturer of these juice boxes. If they realized perhaps that their juice boxes weren't recyclable, then maybe they would make the juice boxes out of a single material that is recyclable. But there are disadvantages to that too. Then the juice may go bad at an earlier date. So there are various challenges in designing packaging, for example, that would dictate whether something can be recyclable or not. Next slide. Okay, so here's some quick common myths about recycling. Everything is recyclable. It's not. Next slide. If there's no demand or if the quality is too low, it can or won't be recycled. A classic example are these rigid or hard plastics like buckets or toys or plastic slides or so on. The way these materials are manufactured, you can't recycle them because there are additives in the plastic materials that make it very challenging to recycle. The other myth is when it doesn't go to a landfill, that's recycling. That's not recycling. To recycle means that the material enters the cycle again. So recycled plastic is used to make plastic products. So therefore, just because it doesn't go to a landfill doesn't mean it's necessarily recyclable or being recycled. The other myth is things can be recycled forever, or at least a really long time. This is one of the most common myths we see. But with each recycling cycle, so imagine if you have a piece of paper. Next slide. You have a piece of paper that you use at your desk. And if you recycle that, next slide, it usually cannot become office paper again. It goes to a lower quality paper, such as a newspaper, for example. Next slide. And if you recycle that newspaper, ultimately it's going to get into a form of paper product that you really end up disposing of, such as a toilet paper, for example. And so typically for paper, as an example, it only has a lifetime of 6 to 8 cycles before it is no longer recyclable. And you see that happen through the different kinds of products that are made from the recycled material. Plastic is the same way, although plastic has more life cycles. But as you continually recycle that and remake that, you end up entering certain things into the cycle that makes it harder to reuse those materials. Next slide. Okay, so how much can be recycled? Another word from Captain Not So Obvious. Did you know that only 34 to 52% of what we actually throw away is recyclable? Next slide. And that's based on how things are manufactured. I already noted that, but that's something we a lot of times like to think that everything is recyclable. And right now, just based on how things are being manufactured, really only about 34 to 52% of that can actually be recycled. Next slide. Okay, so the last couple of things I wanted to touch on before turning it over to Dr. Webb is composting MSW. This is something that is receiving a lot of attention these days because we are trying to increase how much food waste we are diverting from landfills and pointing that to other technologies that use the food waste in a more beneficial way. Composting is one thing that can do that. So composting isn't suitable for all of the MSW, only for particular types of materials such as food waste or yard waste. Paper and many other items that are noted as biodegradable many times can't be composted, at least commercially, because a lot of times commercial compost operations only have a 30-day time period by which they can compost materials. Now, you could certainly compost it in your backyard, and if you're willing to let it sit there for a few months, you could compost certain items. But for a commercial composting operation, that's a lot more challenging. Next slide. These are just some pictures, as you can see, and as you might notice, a commonality amongst a lot of these endpoint technologies is that it usually begins with a tipping area, a place where things are dumped onto a floor, scooped around, moved around. For a composting operation, you're shredding that material using a tub grinder, and then it's going into these big rows. And that piece of machinery that looks like it's on fire and smoke, that's actually steam from the compost pile. And what that does is it actually turns the compost within that pile and puts it back down so that you can degrade this material, and what you end up with compost is a nice fertilizer or amendment that you can add to landscape beds or things like that. Next slide. One of the common issues, though, with compost is getting stuff in there that's not supposed to be in there. This is an iTunes card, and I hope they used it, because that would be a bad loss to see your iTunes card go into a compost pile if you didn't claim the money off of that. But that's a classic example of things that end up in compost piles that shouldn't be there. Glass is another item that ends up in compost piles. And as you might imagine, you do want to put fertilizer on your landscape bed. Don't want to put glass. Don't want to put iTunes cards on there. So that's a common issue when you're dealing with food waste and yard waste, because a lot of times people tend not to put things in the right bin, so you end up with stuff that's not supposed to be there. Next slide. Okay, the last technology I want to talk about is called waste to energy. Keep in mind, when I say waste to energy, I'm specifically talking about burning waste and then using the heat from that to make electricity, okay? Dr. Webb, I believe, will talk about a different kind of technology that is quite different from this. But this is basically burning waste and making electricity from that. As I noted, it's not widely utilized. About 6% of the waste we make across the nation goes to this particular type of technology, although a lot of these facilities tend to be regionally located. And many of these areas where they're located are in areas that have high population densities. So in other words, there's not enough land to locate landfills, and so you end up with these waste energy facilities. If you've ever seen the movie Toy Story 3, you actually get a pretty good tour of a waste energy facility in that movie towards the end. So if you haven't seen it, or if you've seen it and it's been a while, check it out again, because you'll be able to really kind of see how this works. But basically, waste comes into a big bunker, a big crane moves it into a boiler, and then that burns the waste, which creates heat. That heat is then used to drive a turbine. Now, note in this diagram, next slide, that the vast majority of the equipment is pollution control equipment, because since you're burning it, you're creating a lot of and gases that have a lot of bad stuff in there. So you spend a lot of money and a lot of the effort really to get the pollution levels down, since you're discarding a lot of this stuff in the form of gas emissions that go out of that stack on the right. So that's a quick synopsis of kind of how waste is generated, how we manage it, and where it goes. Next slide. And I think that brings me to the end of my presentation. Here are some different video links that you can link to as you have time later. It gives you some nice video footage of some of these technologies, so feel free to take a look at that at your own pace. Next slide. And that's it. Thank you. I think that brings us to our next presenter.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Stolle, for that fast trash talk. I think everybody appreciated everything you went through there. So great. Okay, quickly on to our next speaker, Dr. Aaron Webb. Dr. Webb is a licensed professional engineer, more specifically an agricultural engineer within the Environmental Sciences Division at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory in Tennessee. Dr. Webb has a PhD in agricultural and biological engineering. Her work centers around the design of biomass supply systems, the logistics and transportation of biomass itself. So while you heard a broad passover by Dr. Stolle, you're going to hear a more in-depth, deep dive into technology of waste management. So over to you, Dr. Webb.
Thank you. Can we go to the next slide? So I'll point out that my work, like he was saying, is focused on conversion, looking at feedstocks to convert to bioenergy. I'm not actually a waste expert. Rather, I look at waste as one of several feedstocks that we might use to convert to bioenergy. I can go to the next slide. And the feedstocks particularly I'm talking about, really they center on the ones that Dr. Stolle was pointing out are not recyclable. And here, I think this competition focuses on residential, so some of these may not quite apply, but I wanted to make you aware of all of the urban waste that we might consider as feedstocks for bioenergy production. And that would include waste from construction, demolition, wood, et cetera, paper, cardboard, wastewater, sewage, furniture, the wood inside furniture, Christmas trees, lawn waste is a major one, and then food waste. The two last two, food waste and lawn waste, being the major ones we'll look at. You can go to the next one. So in this presentation, I wanted to highlight three categories, really, of technologies that you might consider. There's a lot of information here that you may want to dig into deeper later on your own terms, and I tried to include some parameters, engineering parameters, that you might use in your design. These are the kind of numbers we would use in that first conceptual design that they talked about earlier, and then as you start to build and model your city, you can get an idea of how it might work, how much production you might have based on your feedstock. So the first one is anaerobic digestion, and that is a biological process where microorganisms will break down the things that are biodegradable, specifically food, sewage, animal manure, which may not apply so much here, but you do see a lot of anaerobic digestion systems on farms, say on dairies and hog production facilities. They would take that animal manure and use anaerobic digestion to convert that. May not apply so much here, but it's an important technology there. And I have there a graph from the American Biogas Council that will give you an idea of the cubic meters of biogas that could be produced per ton of substrate. So you already have some ideas of how much waste your city might produce, and you can figure out how much biogas you would have from each of those sources. Again, the products from anaerobic digestion, biogas is a major one, and it can be, if it's concentrated and processed, originally it's 55 to 65% methane. If that's concentrated, it can work as a substitute for natural gas, so it's a pretty important fuel if it's treated properly. On to the next one. Another technology is thermochemical conversion, and commercially now that is already done with wood chips, chopped switchgrass, technology like that. And then we could also use the woody part of MSW, which again might be the furniture, construction demolition waste, Christmas trees, etc. It's very well suited for wood type feedstocks. And we talk about gasification and pyrolysis as the two main categories there, and those are, they're not burning like the previous speaker talked about. They're rather, they're heating at very high temperatures with little to no oxygen, and then that converts the biomass and converts it into either a bio oil or a syngas, depending on whatever other things are going on in your process. And then those can be upgraded into a biofuel, is what we like to think of it as. So I added some engineering parameters there. So we estimate roughly, it depends a lot on the process and the quality of the feedstock, but roughly about 84 gallons of biofuel per dry ton of feedstock. And dry ton means not considering the moisture. So if you remove the moisture, which it always has moisture in it, but if you were to remove that completely dry, you could get 84 gallons per dry ton. And then I gave a cost there. Roughly, we could produce it for $3.40, and that's gasoline gallon equivalent. So that is the amount of this biofuel you would need to drive your car the same distance as it would go on 1 gallon of gasoline. Now the challenge here is that it requires a very high quality feedstock. So with regard to moisture, particle size, and then contamination, which they talked about. And that's going to be a common theme through this these presentations, I think, is that a lot of these processes require a high quality uniform, or they do work best in a high quality uniform feedstock, and often waste is not that. So a big challenge in using waste for energy is sorting, processing, and getting your waste stream into a high quality feedstock. Go to the next slide. Another conversion process that we like to think about is biochemical conversion. And this one's pretty cool because it's microorganisms that will break down the cell walls. Inside the cell walls of plants, you will have, and then products derived from plants, you will have the sugars in there that are hard to get to. But these microorganisms, when you add, you could use an acid or an enzyme or something to break those apart, and then you have access to those sugars. And when those sugars can be converted to biofuels. Suitable feedstocks might be paper somewhat, but food waste and lawn waste being the primary one. There are three commercial scale biorefineries that we work with. They are in Iowa, and they use the part of the corn plant that's not used for grain. So the leaves, the stalks, and the rest of that corn plant that's usually left on the field, They collect those and they create what we call cellulosic ethanol from those. Well, the same thing could be done from yard waste or other kind of what we would say herbaceous feedstocks, the leaves, the stalks, those kind of things. So, and then the result that it can produce ethanol, and then a byproduct is also lignin. Also in the plant is lignin, and that can be burned for heat and power. So you got two things that can happen there. Again, the major challenge is feedstock quality. It has to be a good, high-quality feedstock for this process to operate well. And we estimate a production rate of roughly 75 gallons per dry ton of feedstock. And again, the processing cost I put here, the total cost to get a gallon of equivalent fuel to a gallon of, or a equivalent to a gallon of gasoline would be $3.10. And the next slide. Okay, so we talked a lot about technology through this. One of the things that I've learned as an engineer as I progress in my career is that many of the challenges we face in designing systems are not technical. We can often figure out the technical solutions, but implementing those and figuring out how to get someone to adopt technology often becomes the barrier and stops or hinders getting these technologies to work. So I pointed out three things here that we often encounter. One is policies and standards, and I just pulled out a cartoon there on what goes where. And we talked about contamination. Well, that's a major issue. So if people are not sorting, if they dispose of their trash improperly, then that can really hinder, if not, you know, ruin the processes later. It makes converting this waste into useful products or disposing of it properly nearly impossible if they're very expensive if folks don't handle it well from the front end. So I think education, you want to think about that in designing a city. Education and teaching people how to treat their waste is important. The other thing is paying for it. You need to think about why someone would do it. That's why I personally like to research and look at deriving energy or other valuable products out of waste streams or other feedstocks, because if there's no one to invest, no one to pay for it, whether that be the city itself, the government, companies, then or private investors, it can't happen. And then going along with the policies and standards is education. You have to get people excited both to invest and to practice the technology. And again, I found these kind of non-technical barriers to be more challenging, maybe because I was trained as an engineer and more interested in the technology. They can be quite challenging. So the next slide. These are some graphics at the Department of Energy. I often do work with the Bioenergy Technologies Office out of the Department of Energy, and they teach each year around Halloween. But it's interesting to point out that roughly one of them says 1.1, another 1.4, so a little over 1 billion pounds of pumpkins will be produced and used this year. Now, and so they point that out. That's such a huge number. And so when we think about that, if we realize that if half of the food waste in the upper left corner, so if half of the food waste was treated with anaerobic digestion or was used for anaerobic digestion, you could produce electricity for 2.5 million homes a year. That's quite large. Or if we looked at half of the overall municipal solid waste was converted into fuels, then we could generate over 6 billion gallons of biofuel. So those are really large numbers and important to consider. And then the last slide, I think. Yeah, my last slide has my contact info. I look forward to any questions.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Webb. I noticed you went through that fairly quickly, so thank you for keeping that in time. I guess now at this point, Maggie, I'll turn it back over to you. I'm sure there are some questions that may have come in for either Dr. Webb or Dr. Stolle. I'll turn it over to you.
Yes, definitely. Thank you, Martin, and thank you, Dr. Stolle and Dr. Webb. I just learned a lot. I hope all of our attendees did too. Let me take a quick glance at some of the questions. I see a lot coming in there, so thank you very much. Let me see. Interesting. So can anyone speak to, I'm not sure if you guys know this or not, but Janet Felston had an interesting question about other countries that might be doing a better job of recycling or waste reduction and management. Do you guys have any knowledge of other kind of methods that other countries might be using? If not, it's okay.
I can say a few things. This is Brian. Interestingly, the vast majority of the world is catching up on how to manage waste, and as they generate more and more. I think if you even just Google China solid waste, you'll see they're facing, with their enormous population explosion, huge issues in how to deal with solid waste. So really, if you look at the two prime areas globally that are probably doing the quote-unquote best job, and there, when I say that, that there's still a lot that can be done. It really would be the European Union first, and the countries that are within the European Union, followed probably by Canada and the United States. But there's a difference, and Dr. Webb talked about these non-technology issues that come up, and she mentioned policies as one of them. And the reason we would put the European Union before the United States in terms of its ability to manage waste sustainably really is because if you think about that, in the European Union, they have policies that place rather large taxes on certain endpoint technologies. Most of the technologies that they place the tax on would be a landfill. And so if you dispose of a ton of waste in a landfill, you actually would pay in Europe about double what you would pay to have it disposed of via other technologies. And what that has done is that has actually made the implementation of many of the technologies that Dr. Webb talked about extremely viable in Europe. Because that tax money, in essence, subsidizes the implementation of these next generation types of technologies to gasify the waste materials and so on. And so you don't have that system in place here in the United States. It's still a very capitalistically driven type of system. There are no formal taxation policies on waste management infrastructure. And so in that regard, in the United States, one of the reasons you see landfills being the dominant form of endpoint technology is simply because it's extremely cheap to dispose of waste in a landfill. As an example, if you dispose of a ton of waste in the southwest United States, that's going to only cost you $18, whereas if you dispose of a ton of waste in England, that'll cost you almost $200. And so there's a vast difference, and it really relates to the economics and policies.
Great. Thank you, Brian. We have another question from Madison, which I think any of the three of you could answer. She wants to know, what are the advantages and disadvantages of waste to energy? Anybody?
I would say that the advantages, I think, are pretty obvious. You can take what was a waste stream and would be filling up a landfill and will reduce the life of your landfills. If you're putting things that could be used for other things into a landfill, you're reducing the life, or you're expanding how big your landfill has to be. That's not cheap. There is cost to disposing material like that. And then another advantage is that you're gaining useful products like power, fuel, energy of some sort. The disadvantage is that it's expensive and it's difficult. In fact, these technologies I've talked about today, they're in practice, and we do those commercially, but not with waste streams right now. And mostly because where we were talking about the sorting and the getting a good, nice, uniform feedstock, that's a real challenge. I do think it's possible in the future. That's why I included those here. We're talking about future cities, so I think those are possible and doable. But there has to be investment and technology developed to do that better and more cost-effectively.
Great. Thank you, Aaron.
I would add something to that as well. Another thing that waste energy does is that it does take out – so keep in mind, I mentioned during my talk that people place things in the wrong bin all the time. And with a waste energy type system, you kind of remove that human decision element out of it, because in essence you can take all of the material to a single location. Let's say if you're going to gasify a waste or even burn it, someone doesn't have to choose whether this particular plastic material has to go in a recycling bin or not. They can basically put everything in the bin, and in essence, the waste is transformed into energy without them having to make a conscious choice as to which is the correct bin to to put it in. So that is another side effect, and you see that a lot. I call it the human behavioral element as it relates to recycling, and that's huge. Getting people educated to make the right choice is a big deal.
Definitely, I agree with that. We got a great question from Kristen. She wanted to know, how do engineers predict and project the future needs for municipal solid waste management?
Erin, do you want to take
that? Anybody want to take a stab?
I'm not exactly sure where that question is getting. So I'm not a waste expert, so I don't know that one. I'm more focused on energy. And so if I tailor that question a bit to look at energy needs for the future, because that's usually where I'm more focused, is how much energy are we going to need and where can we possibly get it in a more cost-effective and sustainable way than using fossil fuels. We have to look at things like population growth and projected fuel demands for the future. And the Department of Energy actually does a nice job projecting that out. It's an imperfect science because you're trying to predict what's going to happen in the world, and that's always wrong. So it's just a matter of how wrong you are. But that's where I think it was Martin early on talking about the engineering design process. The nice thing about, in my case, I do a lot of computer simulation, not all that different probably than what you guys will do in SimCity. And those are nice because we can play games. So we can look at different scenarios. We can, and it's cheap to do that. So in real life, if you try to do an experiment on a huge city, you can't do that. It's not cost effective. But in a simulation, you can play games and look at different scenarios, and that gives us some boundaries, some ranges of what options we might need to look at.
Great.
I'll add one thing that also dovetails in with water is when you're looking at future use or future production of waste, you might consider, is that city going to be recycling more? Because it may not continue to be the same amount of pounds per day per person, or is that city going to be reducing the amount of waste they generate? So taking into account waste reduction processes and education, public education may impact the volume of trash that you may be generating at some point in the future.
Definitely. Great. And to build on that question, we got a question from Jonathan, a student, and he wants to know, what are some methods that you either know about or you might recommend for reducing the amount of non-recyclable trash that gets into the recycling stream? That's a big question, I know. It's a million-dollar question.
I can maybe speak to that a little bit, but I think the overall answer is probably that there isn't a definitive, I'd call it a silver bullet solution yet for that. I mean, I think there's a twofold thing going on. One is that, as I mentioned before, what's being manufactured that we purchase as a society ultimately becomes our waste stream. And how the companies that manufacture everything from our toothpaste to the footballs we play with to and how they package it and put it on the shelves is very important. I mean, how many times have probably any of us gone into, say, a Best Buy or a Staples or something and bought a tiny little USB drive or a mouse for a computer, and the mouse is in there, but you know, you almost can't see it because it's wrapped in so much plastic packaging that you know you really have to kind of carve it out with a chainsaw to get the mouse out of it. But then you've got this huge piece of trash that you literally throw away the minute you buy it. That's an example of where consideration for one is that plastic material actually recyclable. So manufacturers really have a lot to say, and that kind of gets to Martin's point about waste reduction. If manufacturers could produce either products that we're going to buy that have a lot less packaging, or if, and maybe this is actually both, or if they can provide packaging that's much smaller than what they provide now, we have just reduced our waste stream. And you also reduce the contamination in terms of recycling by being able to have materials that are recyclable in the first place. The second thing I would just note is more of a process-oriented thing. A lot of policies now dictate certain recycling goals, and a lot of states and cities are striving towards higher and higher and higher recycling goals, and so they're trying to push more things into a recycling bin when in many cases, again, back to the manufacturing point, things aren't being manufactured to be more recyclable, so you end up with people pushing things into recycling bins that really shouldn't go there in the first place. And so there's a little bit of a disconnect in some cases between the actual policies that are out there versus what's actually doable from an operational standpoint. So in terms of a design for this, that's another consideration is can in the future you think of a city where manufacturers generate packaging that is completely biodegradable, completely recyclable, so that you really eliminate the contamination issue. That would be a huge advantage.
Great. Thank you, Brian. We got an interesting question about glass from Carol. She was wondering what are the uses of glass when it's recycled? And she mentioned that at their MRF, it is crushed and used in the bottom of landfill for filtering. Are there other better uses? And I know you spoke about paper and plastic and the different life cycles. So what's the life cycle of glass?
Oh, glass. Glass is a four-letter word in the recycling industry these days, mainly because, so a lot of the marketability, and this kind of gets to Dr. Webb's point about these intangible, non-technology-oriented considerations, cost being a huge factor. So when you look at commodity values, which really drive the recycling industry, glass has one of the lowest commodity values of all the recyclables you could get. In many cases, yes, you do see glass going to glass bottle manufacturers to make new glass bottles. That's a fairly small portion of the overall glass waste stream. Another portion is used as underlayment for roads. So before putting the asphalt down, you'll see crushed glass being used. And there are more niche applications that really don't pull a huge segment of the glass stream. But you do see that also as a form of daily cover on a landfill. I have seen situations, and I hate to say this, but because commodity values are so low that there are recycling facilities that bunker their glass in hopes that the commodity value will increase and make it profitable for them. If the commodity values don't get to that point, they actually take the bunker glass and put it in a landfill because it actually costs more for them to actually get rid of it. Or it's not as sustainable. It actually creates a higher emissions footprint to transport glass hundreds of miles to someone who could buy it versus simply disposing of it in a landfill. And so that's a challenge. Glass is a big challenge right now.
Wow, sounds like it. Thank you, Brian. Holly has an interesting question about electronic waste, talking about computer waste. And should it be handled differently? And how might the future of waste management be affected by electronic waste, because nowadays everybody has, you know, a cell phone or so many different types of electronics. How might that impact the waste stream itself?
I can take that one again. Please jump in if anybody wants to. A couple things I'd say about e-waste. One is that you notice the equipment that I showed in my MRF slides. You cannot process electronic waste in a MRF because think of a computer monitor going over those steel screens and being shredded up into a million pieces. That doesn't work for a couple of reasons. One is that e-waste, if you open up a phone, for example, all the circuitry is made out of precious metals that can be reclaimed, like gold, platinum, other materials. The other thing is the circuit boards are made out of actually some pretty nasty stuff. Brominated flame retardants are part of that. Things that you would not want to grind up or turn into small pieces and get it airborne, it could cause some huge health issues for workers. And so e-waste is a unique animal in that sense because, one, it has a lot of precious metals and materials that could be reused, but you can't run it through the typical recycling system. People have spoken of the coming e-waste tsunami in that regard because a lot of electronic materials are sitting in people's basements, attics, extra bedrooms, and so on, that at some point they are going to say, I've got to get rid of this. And part of that is because of privacy issues. You know, I've got all of my family pictures and all of our credit card statements and stuff in electronic form on this computer, and did I really delete them or not? And so there's that sort of situation. But ultimately, there's going to have to be some infrastructure developed for e-waste. Right now, there really isn't a huge infrastructure for e-waste. A lot of e-waste is being managed by small companies in small areas, cities across the U.S., and it's not really a standardized industry like recycling and composting and so on. So that's a huge challenge.
Great, thank you. And hey, Erin, you might be able to speak to this one from Renee. She's wondering what kind of bio trash might be a major factor in the future.
Bio trash. Well, I don't know what would change that much over time. I think food waste and lawn waste will continue. The herbaceous kind of lawn waste will continue to be major players, because while a lot of others, you can change packaging, you can change things to eliminate, you know, to reduce the material entering the waste stream, it's harder to do that with food and, you know, but creative ways, I think, to handle food so that they don't become food waste are important as well. Anything you do to eliminate a waste before it gets in there is important. So I see food and lawn waste as being major players. Even in a large city, you still have a lot of folks really demand green space. So you're still going to have, I think, more and more green space, actually. As you move people into the city, they're going to want, even if you're not in a suburb, they're still going to want parks and whatnot. So they're still going to want, you're still going to have land managed in that way. Other bio-waste? I don't know. That's a good question.
Yeah, hey, that was good enough for me. Does anyone want to speak to something that I'm not a huge fan of, personally, styrofoam? Got a question about that and kind of its impact. Anybody?
I'll just note that, yeah, styrofoam is it's one of those things where, you know, a lot of trash is being tracked based on its weight. And so styrofoam is extremely light, and it's not particularly recyclable per se, although there is some styrofoam recycling going on. A lot of times that the styrofoam is in essence squished air is sucked out of it, so you end up with more of a compact sort of plasticized cube, if you will. But you know, the areas where styrofoam packaging is used, that's slowly being eliminated. I know in universities across now, they used to have to-go styrofoam clamshell packaging, and now they've used washable hard plastic containers that can be taken back to the cafeterias. And so that's certainly something that I would think over time styrofoam would and certainly should be removed, because there's not a lot of value in styrofoam in terms of reuse.
Great, thank you. We have time for about one or two more questions, and this one I think is a pretty good wrap-up question from Sarah. She wants to know, what are the most cutting-edge technologies to solve the various challenges that all the speakers have brought up in their presentations today? What could our future city participants kind of start thinking about? What's on the cutting edge? What's innovative in the field of waste management? It's a hard question, I know. It's a big question. Maybe your favorite, if you've heard of one?
Well, this is Erin. We touched on quite a few, actually, because in my talk on waste to energy, as I mentioned, these are not used right now very extensively at all to convert waste to energy. And the reason is it's hard, and I think it's doable, but it's difficult, and there has to be some innovation and cost reductions and improvements in the feedstock stream coming in, and process improvements are going to have to be done. Again, I think it's doable, but I think it's not quite there yet. But in a future city, I think it could be incorporated.
Great.
Yeah, I would add one more thing to that, too, is that, you know, one of the upcoming trends for recycling, so if a future city were to continue to segregate its waste material, you know, as you might imagine, you know, if you set three trash cans on the side of your house, one for recycling, one for landfill, and one for, say, compostable material, you've got three trucks running the road. That's not really, if you think about it, the long term, that's really not what we want to be doing, right? So one of the shorter term trends that bears a lot of consideration is the use of what's called mixed waste processing facilities. And so in that scenario, you put all of your waste in one bin. It goes to something that looks like a MRF facility, but yet it has additional equipment to separate the food waste from the other recyclable materials from the stuff that you simply just has no recycling future or reuse future. And you separate all of that from one single bin into its various usable components and non-usable components. And so in that regard, instead of separating things out at a curb or in different cans, it allows things to be dealt with one single facility. And there are a few of those that even exist today in the United States, but the biggest limitation has been finding technologies that can really improve the process. And as an example, you know, one of the advancements that could really help would be using things like facial recognition software, for example, and algorithms to identify what a particular piece of trash is and separate that as it's going down the conveyor belt, as an example. That technology is not there yet. But if it could be, you could have a situation where you have a facility that literally could separate all of the waste we generate while you kind of use that in concert with minimizing the waste stream on the manufacturing side. And then you kind of end up with a nice technology solution where you would implement, say, one of Dr. Webb's technologies that she mentioned alongside of reusing and recycling certain components so that you really eliminate the need to dispose of things via landfills, for example.
Great. Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Martin. Thank you, Dr. Staley and Dr. Webb, for joining us today. And thank you to all of our Future City participants. We got through, I believe, most of the questions. If we did not get yours answered, feel free to send your question to info, that's I-N-F-O, at futurecity.org, and we will do our best to get our experts to answer it and send you a response. Thank you again. I hope all of the Future City participants learned a lot and are excited to kind of get back to their classrooms and start brainstorming their innovative and futuristic waste management system. And I'm looking forward to seeing them at the regional and national competitions. Thank you again for joining us today. And please feel free to fill out the survey that you'll get once you exit the webinar. Thank you again very much.